Okay, so as a coordinator of the FoodSHIFT 2030 project, I have to say, I really have to say it's simply amazing to be here together with you today. I've really been looking forward to this day for a long time. I've been looking forward to meeting finally all of you in person. There's a lot of you that I've met on Skype, online meetings, and suddenly you are here today, stepping into reality. And I'm also really happy to having all of you together here with me today. So, therefore I would like all of you, all consortium partners, all stakeholders, all guests, representatives from the EU and REA, please, let's take a deep breath and enjoy this moment together. And then let's reflect a bit on why are we here today? So why are we here today? We are here today because in one way or the other, we have all contributed to making the FoodSHIFT project a reality. And in one way or the other, yeah, we all are motivated to make a real difference in the world. And we are here today also because you and I, we share a common vision. We all want to transform the food system to better meet the needs of the people and the planet. And I know we all come with different backgrounds. We come with specific expertises, and we come with our personal hopes for the project. So what we're going to do over the next couple of days is that we're going to bring all of this together. We are going to bring all of this together to build the FoodSHIFT 2030 community. We're going to start working together on achieving the overall goals of the project. And we're going to start helping each other achieving our personal goals of the project. And whatever you contribute with, it is important. Because we cannot postpone addressing the triple challenge of climate change, malnutrition, and urbanization. We have an important task. So what are we looking at here? Well, our house is on fire. Our food is killing us. And we have disconnected ourselves from the land that feeds us. In a business as usual scenario, if we are not doing anything to limit global greenhouse gas emissions, then the global average temperature will increase by 4 degrees in 2100. 70% of all deaths in Europe can be ascribed to non-communicable diseases such as diabetes, strokes, and also certain types of cancer that are all significantly affected by what we eat and also how much we eat. Furthermore, the average GDP per capita in urban regions is 24% higher than the EU average. Whereas if we look at the rural regions, then the GDP per capita is 30% lower than the EU average. So with all these challenges, we cannot delay action. We have to act now. And our youth has called upon us to act. We urgently need a green transition of our society, and we urgently need a transformation of our food system. Research has documented, including the recent publication from the Eat Lancet Commission that was published last year, that a healthy diet is not a vegan diet, but a primarily plant-based diet. And also that a plant-based diet will lead to lower greenhouse gas emissions. And wouldn't it be amazing if we could provide safe, healthy, nutritious, and affordable food for all? Wouldn't it be amazing if this food could be produced, distributed, consumed, and recycled in a sustainable food system? Wouldn't it be amazing if this food system could contribute to reducing global greenhouse gas emissions and meeting the target of the Paris Agreement? And wouldn't it be amazing if this food system could also reconnect us with the land and create livable cities and rural areas where humans can work together and exist together with respect and love for one another? Wouldn't that be amazing? Yes, that would be amazing. And that is the ambition of the FoodSHIFT 2030 project. So, you may say that I'm a dreamer. And that this is not an easy task. But the time is ripe. The time is ripe. The FoodSHIFT 2030 project comes at the right time and at the right place. In October last year, 14 mayors from the C40 network met here in Copenhagen to sign the Good Food Policies Declaration. So in this declaration, they are committing to align public food procurement policies with the planetary health diet. They are committing to support an overall increase in healthy plant-based food, and they are committing to reduce food waste by 50%. So, as already mentioned by Tatiana, then last year, also in December, the European Commission launched a roadmap for the European Green Deal, featuring a farm-to-fork strategy, which is still being developed, but we know it's going to focus on more efficient, sustainable food systems with reduced food loss and waste, focusing on healthy food consumption and better informed citizens. Also, the agricultural sector has actually started to acknowledge the winds of change. I was attending a conference in January this year for Danish farmers and advisors, and they invited the CEO of a major plant-based food company here in Denmark to give the keynote speech. And his message to the farmers was clear. You need to get ready to produce oats and peas and broad beans for a plant-based future. Only 2 days ago, I attended a conference here in the Danish parliament focusing on how plant-based food could contribute to the Danish government target of reducing emissions. The Danish government has a target of reducing emissions by 70%, and the food system could, of course, contribute to that. So at this conference, the farmer advisory services confirmed that given, of course, a demand, the farmers are ready to convert from animal feed production to plant production for human consumption. And then last year, yesterday, I was attending this conference organized by CCAFS, University of Copenhagen, and the Danish Agriculture and Food Council on how to get to a zero emission food system. And at this conference, I was actually chairing a panel session also featuring Ben here, our consortium partner, on how farmers should collaborate with social movements to transform the food system. Also, consumption patterns are changing. Consumers increasingly demand sustainable, healthy, and climate-friendly food. And they also highly value local food. It's a trend. So a recent study shows that European consumers, they are consciously cutting out meat from their diets. So increasingly identifying themselves as flexitarians with one, maybe, or two meat-free days per week, or maybe even as little as one meat day per week. So change is happening. Transition is happening. And transformation is happening. And you are all a part of this transformation. In the FoodSHIFT 2030 project, we're aiming to launch an ambitious citizen-driven transformation of the European food system towards low-carbon circular future, including also a focus on the less meat, more plant-based diets. And we are inviting everyone to join. So luckily, we are not starting completely from scratch, because working with 10 major themes across 9 city regions, we already have really great momentum to move forward and make real change that we can all believe in. So I would like to show you some examples of transformative food system innovations that is going on in our city regions. So I really like this photo. So it's from Avignon, and it's showing children that are harvesting squash that they are then later going to use in the school canteen. Also in Avignon, 15% to 40% of the food in the school kitchens is now local food, and always more than 20% is organic food. This has now made Avignon the national leader in food procurement for local food. In Barcelona, the Fab City Global Initiative is working together with the Next Food startup as one of the innovations to develop this high technological urban farming systems in a solid system, optimizing resource use efficiencies and providing food. In Bari, CIHM has created an innovation hub, and they're working together with the municipality of Bari to use abandoned land and provide for entrepreneurs to develop sustainable food production. In Wroclaw, Ruels is working together with the local authorities to make a strategy for the Green Valley of Health for food. And FER has been working to make these eco-fairs, local eco-fairs, and a bazaar where people, where consumers can meet producers and buy local food. And in Berlin, Tempelhof Vision is working together with the Berlin Food Policy Council to make a food campus in the old Tempelhof Airport building. I heard there are some challenges here with this. Hopefully this project can help push it forward. We'll hear more about that. But until that is happening, you are gathering experiences in Berlin on how to get ready to develop this campus. So, in Brasov, Highclear Consulting and Iceberg is working together to support the brand, a local brand, and distribute it to the hospitality sector. The local chefs, as we can see here, are rediscovering traditional recipes. And we also see an increase actually in vegan restaurants in Brasov. So this is in Athens, where EA is developing a comprehensive school program to teach children about ecosystems and natural systems so that they will be better stewards of the earth. And in Ostende, there's been established a park in the city center, an agricultural park. And to support also community support agriculture, since the establishment of this park, the members of the of this community supported agriculture has doubled. And then finally here in Copenhagen, we've had a unique collaboration between the Copenhagen House of Food and the municipality of Copenhagen that has been able to drive significant change through specifying requirements for public procurement. So by including in this tender requirements that there should be a supply of organic food and also provide capacity building for the kitchen workers, the share of organic food, as mentioned also by Tina, has been increased, I think, from 60% in 2007 to almost 90% today. Also in Copenhagen, we have the startup Circular Food Technology, who is working on developing new food products based on food waste streams, and PlantJammer, who has developed an app based on an AI-powered recipe generator to make it easier for everyone to cook with plant-based ingredients. So these are just some of the examples of food system innovations in our city regions. And in the FoodSHIFT 2030 project, we're going to take these innovations and other innovations, and we are going to mature, combine, and upscale them to transform the European food system. So, how are we going to do it? Well, most of you have already seen this figure before. It gives a pretty good overview of the structure of the FoodSHIFT 2030 project. At the very core of the project, you find the FoodSHIFT Accelerator Labs. They are the core of the project. This is where the innovation is going to take place. And I'm really excited to have all the labs now finally together here in Copenhagen. So, these FoodSHIFT Accelerator Labs, they will be established in Work Package 1, which is led by ILVO. It's called Facilitating the Innovation. So the labs, they're going to be established as open innovation living labs, featuring collaboration with the key food system stakeholders in the city region. And that includes both the private companies, the local authorities, the NGOs, the civil servants, and the researchers, and the civil society. So in Work Package 1, we are going to first explore the existing food system innovations and determine their potential for further development. Then we are going to define common priorities and develop tailor-made trajectories for each of the labs, for the further process. In work package 2, which is led by Swiss Metro, Dirk sitting here, Gustavo, then we are going to accelerate the food system solutions. We are going to implement what the evaluators called the groundbreaking mechanism of accelerating the food system solutions. And we're going to do that by also increasing their technological and societal readiness levels. So the idea here is that we're going to mature, we're going to combine, and we are going to upscale the food system innovations, including also the development of business plans. Oh, I forgot this. So in work package 3, we are then going to first define some indicators, also together with you, all of you in the labs, what are the relevant indicators for assessing the environmental, economic, and social benefits of the food system innovations, and also their effects on food security and food sovereignty. And here, INRA will also contribute with an advanced geographical analysis of the food system. In work package 4, which is led by self, we are going to work on governing this transition. So here we will co-create good food governance strategies for food systems. And this will probably also be the focus of the final conference of the FoodSHIFT project, which will take place in Brussels, focus on policy, and organized also by IFOAM. In work package 5, which is a super important work package, we are then going to multiply the impact of the FoodSHIFT 2030 project. This work package will be led by Agriter. And what we are going to do first in this work package is to exchange knowledge between these 9, you could say, front-runner city regions, the FoodSHIFT accelerator labs. This will already start today, now at this kickoff. Then after that, we are going to establish the 27 FoodSHIFT enabler labs and then transfer knowledge from the initial 9 labs to these 27 enabler labs. And then we are also going to transfer knowledge further on via city and region networks, including, of course, the Fab City Global Initiative, also the C40 network, and the Sustainable Food Cities. So to do this, we will be assisted, of course, by IAC, the EAT Foundation that recently joined the consortium, and Sustain in the UK. In work package 6, we are then going to operationalize these so-called impact pathways. I will be leading this work package, and in this work package we will operationalize the impact pathways and also create the blueprints of the FoodSHIFT 2030 project, those things that would kind of live on after the project ends. So the impact pathway here on citizen empowerment will be led by Ilvo. And in this impact pathway, we will make sure that citizen empowerment is addressed in all work packages across all labs. And we will create a citizen empowerment scheme as the blueprint. The impact pathway on job creation will be led by University of Milan. Also making sure that job creation is addressed in all labs and across work packages. And we will develop a job creation platform. The impact pathway on sustainability will be led by Draxis to make sure sustainability is covered everywhere. And here we will develop, based on the indicators and the assessments in work package 3, we will develop a more like simplified sustainability scoring system that can be used by other city regions. And then finally, very importantly, we also have the impact pathway on food system transition, which will be led by Swiss Metro. So here we will make sure that transition is also considered across the project, and we will co-create a food system transition toolkit that also kind of integrates all the other FoodSHIFT blueprints. So as like a toolkit for everybody else to use. Work package 7 on dissemination, exploitation, communication is led by IAC. And here we will also start working together today on creating this dissemination communication plan. That will of course also feature all the outputs from the labs and from the impact pathways, the blueprints. And work package 8 is on the project management. So here we are seeking to establish like an efficient and friendly management structure. So to make sure that we achieve all the deliverables of the project. So if the labs are at the core of the project, then we should say also that citizens and the citizen-driven innovation is the cornerstone, or the kind of the gear wheel here that turns everything. So therefore, we're going to work together here in the FoodSHIFT 2030 project to fuel the transformative power of citizens that are already engaged in developing sustainable food system solutions. We are going to empower the entrepreneurs in SMEs and NGOs to mature, combine, and upscale their food system innovations. And we're going to empower the civil servants and local authorities to develop sustainable food system policies. And then we're also going to empower, of course, the citizens to make informed decisions about their food consumption and influence the way the food is produced, distributed, and recycled. So together, we are going to transform the food system. So, are you ready? Let's get on with it.